Tonight's lecture and this week's educational activities, which started on Monday, have been made possible by the generous support of donors, including many patients, Sansum Clinic trustees and staff, individual physicians in the community, physician groups, and corporate contributors. We also want to recognize Cottage Hospital's role in being the title sponsor yet again. And, Ron Werft is not here. I think Bob Norris, I don't see Bob, but we want to thank Cottage and their leadership for helping us with this program. The selection committee for the visiting professor program is organized by Dr. Ron Latimer and is composed of Sansum Clinic's active surgical staff. That's Drs. Jim Dunn, Greg Graney, Rosa Choi, Paul Chizik, and Mark Zaray. Also, Dr. Jeffrey Govin and Steve Kaminsky, who represent this Cottage full-time teaching staff, participate actively in this program. The visiting professor of surgery educational program was established by Dr. Latimer with Sansum Clinic to advance surgical educational opportunities for community physicians, as well as surgical residents in training here at Cottage Hospital, and to demonstrate our commitment to surgical excellence. I want to just remind everybody that immediately following this program, there'll be a reception in the lobby across the street at the Jack and Julie Nadel lobby, right across the street. Before I turn this program over to Dr. Latimer, I'd like to acknowledge a few guests in the audience this evening. From Sansum Clinic's Board of Trustees, we have our board chair, Vicki, I've made you a doctor. Actually, we gave Vicki a coat once in case she, but Vicki Hazard, who is not a doctor, but is basically the boss of all of us. Our trustees, Dr. Ron Latimer, Julie McGovern, Jim McNamara, Eddie Rosenblatt, Marianne Schall, and Beth Voss. And from our Women's Council, Julie Nadel and Bobby Rosenblatt. George. And George Rusnak. Finally, I just want to mention that Dr. Freischlag and I crossed paths for a few years in the late 80s when we were both at UCLA beginning our careers. I commented to her, which is very true, that she looks a lot more like she did then than I do. It was very obvious to all of us at that time that Dr. Freischlag was going places, and you will hear about many of those places in a minute. But I do want to thank her again for making this week in Santa Barbara one of those places. So thank you again for joining us, and I'll turn it over to Ron Latimer.
Thank you very much, Kurt. I'm going to do the PBS commercial. I want to thank all the donors and people like you who have supported this program. We could not do it without you. And it's been a success, and it continues to be a success, and we would continue to encourage your support. Now, I'm going to, if I went through Julie's CV, it's about a half a ream of paper, and you all would not want me to do that. But I'm going to take you to Decatur, Illinois, where a young lady is born. She had a grandfather who told her, people are going to tell you that you can't do that. I suspect that was the spark. I don't know whether she read The Little Train That Could, but I did. And I'm going to recount The Little Train That Could and Did. So she goes from Decatur to the University of Illinois. She wants to be a teacher. She took some biology courses, and apparently at that time someone suggested that there wasn't a need for teachers anymore. Well, but nonetheless, that did change her course a little bit, and she went to Rush Medical School, where she excelled, and then she decided to broaden her fields and expanse and came to the West Coast and went to UCLA, where she took a general surgery residency, then went on to take another difficult residency, which was a vascular surgery residency, and again, she excelled in that. So her motto was, I think I can, and she did. After a period of time there, she was then recruited to go and head other departments in the Midwest, and finally, she got an offer to go to Baltimore, where she not only was the head of the Department of Vascular Surgery, the Department of Surgery, but chairman of the Department of Surgery, which she served for 11 years. So I think I can, and once again, an offer came to become the dean of the medical school at Davis. I'm not sure where the little train that could is going to go next, but I can tell you that there isn't a surgical organization she does not belong to. She happens to be the chairman of the Board of Regents for the American College of Surgeons, which is probably the highest honor you can get. She's on every important vascular surgery committee, board. She's chairman of most of those. So I want to introduce the little train that could, Julie Freischlag.
So I have read that book. That was one of my favorite books, and maybe that's where it came from. So I do want to thank everyone for a lovely week. My husband Phil and I have just been treated so nicely. We've met many people, the residents, your surgeons, the people that really make the hospital work, and I've gotten to get to know them in many different forms, and even gave a talk to the internist today, which was really great. And I'm very impressed how the place has grown. I looked at it in 1979 for residency as I was interviewing down the coast and was very impressed with it. Ended up at UCLA, but it really has grown, and the patients you take care of and how you take care of them are amazing. I went to the breast cancer meeting at noon yesterday, and I was blown away at the sophistication, the genetic testing. I had no idea what they were talking about for most of the cases because I don't practice breast surgery, but I was really impressed with that, as well as your tumor boards, your residents are able to present. I've been around the halls of the hospital, the intense care you give those in the intensive care unit, all of it is wonderful. And I want to thank Dr. McKittrick for being here. I've known him since I was an intern, as we are both but served on the American Board of Surgery and have known each other through it. It's delightful that you came to join me. And then many people, the world is very small. You know, Dr. Choi sitting here, I appreciate her. She was one of my students I gave advice to years and years ago. Found out that other people's children and others are along the way. So our sphere is very small. I want to thank all the donors. I can't tell you how important, I'll touch on that in my talk, how donors and philanthropy are going to play a critical role in healthcare in the future. Between the federal government, there was a little reprieve this week for the NIH, but there's tough times coming, not only for research, but clinical care and those that care in order to maintain a great place to take care of patients as well as your family. We thank you all, and that's one of my big roles. What a vice chancellor does, raises money, and I did a lot of that at Hopkins as well, too. And for us to be generous ourselves is very important as we go forward. So I chose this title, Leading Through Times of Change, Principles of Leadership, because I can't imagine us waking up every morning now. I turn on the news to see what happened, don't you? I mean, something had happened. Every day something's happened. Sometimes it's good, sometimes it's bad, but there's always something, whether it's weather-related or whether it's politically related or healthcare-related, there's always something happening. And the this lecture I give at the American College of Surgeons at a leadership course and also at a course at Harvard on strategic planning for clinical departments, mainly because I think we need to learn to go along with what is changing, and instead of being behind or saying how much it doesn't matter or saying how much it bothers us, which lots of it bothers me too. It's time to lead and be very positive about how we can make these changes turn into something amazing. And especially for the young people, I met a lot of really great residents here. They're the reasons we need to lead. We need to show them the way so they'll be better than we ever were. And leadership, I think, is something we need to practice. So I thought I'd focus on that today and wind it a little round with healthcare, but also maybe some personal stories of how I was the little engine that actually came out of a small town in Illinois and ended up doing amazing things because of opportunities given me. So leadership. So leadership is an improvisational art. It really means to go forth and die. You know, we don't want anybody to do that. Just like when my son, Taylor, finds out that we go to retreats, he goes, "Mom, why would you ever retreat? You want to go forward. You don't want to go to a retreat." So leadership can be very lonely, as you see in this picture, but also it needs to be very flexible. Now, sustaining leadership, making sure you are a leader, when you think of people that you really admire as leaders as I give this talk, what is it about those people that are able to sustain leadership through many times? I asked Ron today what has motivated him to give so much to Cottage Hospital and to the clinic, and why does he keep continuing to care, and how come he keeps leading through running the tumor board and running things and caring about this lectureship? And so I think part of it is that you need to have capacity to see what is happening to you and your initiative as it's happening. You have to be in real time. I think some of the mistakes I've seen leaders make is you really wish it was 20 years ago, you know, whether it was because your feet didn't hurt or you were taller or you weren't gray or whatever it was, you really wish it was back then versus wishing it was now and wishing it's going to be better where you're going. And one big benefit for that is hanging out with young people, which was wonderful this week, that they will make you realize where it's going. Now, this is a great book to read. Ronald Heifetz and Marty Linsky have written quite a few books on leadership. This one's my favorite because it's Leadership on the Line, Staying Alive Through the Dangers of Leading. And for surgeons, this sounds intriguing, doesn't it? It's something we would like to do. And it really tells you what to do when it's really dangerous. And there's times where it's going to be really dangerous, just like when someone is bleeding or someone has been in an accident or an operation doesn't turn out the way you want. How do you stay leading during those processes? And that's certainly why I took this new job at Davis, is that it's time to really lead with lots of energy now, because we really don't know what's going to happen with healthcare reform. So in this book, they talk about how to figure out what to do, because when you do take leadership positions, what do? And they talk about getting on the balcony. So just like the beautiful balcony that Phil and I have seen over at the Four Seasons, we appreciate that. As you look out, what do you see? And how can you distinguish technical work from adaptive challenges? Find out where your people are. That's what I'm starting to do at Davis. Actually, it was great to come here, because after 2 weeks of meeting lots and lots of people, you know, what's going on in the Department of Radiology? What's going on at the Center for Healthcare Policy and Research? What do people really feel that can't change? What's that song beneath the words? What are those core principles that really make your hospital and your clinic go? And what kind of things do you need to change? And then you have to really read behavior. I've been watching everyone all week. The residents were a little funny. I knew lots of stories last night. But if you listen to people talk and see how they act, you'll get clues about what's very important. So you do need to think politically, and perhaps that's not the easiest thing, and the word politics is probably one of the worst words these days, isn't it? The way you can do this is to find partners, and I've seen lots of that going on here. I certainly found lots of partners at Hopkins to help lead. I'm looking for good partners at Davis to help lead. And then for everyone that really thinks you're not doing a good job, you really want to Velcro them right on your hip. There's nothing more disarming than someone that really doesn't like you and wish you weren't around, is to invite them to sit right next to you, ask them to dinner, ask their opinion, and they wonder what's going on. And pretty soon they either have to join you or have to leave, one of the two. And sometimes leaving's not a bad thing. But you need to really keep your opposition close. With every change, you have to take responsibility for things that you're doing, whether it's because you want to make it a mess and change it, or whether you did something and it didn't turn out right. And you need to acknowledge their loss. When I first came to Hopkins, you know, Dr. Cameron, who you met 2 years ago, had been there, you know, for 17 years, and I had one faculty member say, "You don't do anything like Dr. Cameron. You don't look like him. You don't talk like him. You don't act like him." And he goes, "What are we going to do?" And I said, "Well, if I tried to be Dr. Cameron, I would fail. You know, so I'm going to be me. It's going to be all right. But either you're going to have to go along with the flow, or you're going to need to go." And so that person went off to be chair of surgery somewhere else, which was what he wanted to do. But at that time, you really need to acknowledge it is different. And the most important thing, I think, for all of us is to model the behavior you would like. As you're leading a team, they watch everything you do. I know I was watched a lot this week by the residents and faculty, and even as I walked down the hall, seeing what does she do. And now with my new job, they're watching, you know, what you do. When I went to Hopkins, they even commented on what I wore. There were texts and emails about she wore purple, she wore blue. You know, I came from LA, so it was like I had to alter a little bit what I wore. But you have to really model that behavior. I've had so many people come up to me and say, "Because you taught me," one is one of your new vascular surgeons, Edward Lee, I taught him as a third year resident, "because you taught me that, I became a vascular surgeon," you know, and that was quite a few years ago. I got an email from another cardiac surgeon, John Chen, who was just president of the Western Thoracic, and in his presidential address, he remembers I was helping him do an aneurysm. I don't remember this at all, but he does, that it was a really tough aneurysm. It was an open aneurysm, and we were having difficulty getting around the proximal neck. And he said, he suggested to me in his speech, "Why don't you come over here and do this? I just can't do this." And my answer was passionately, "Yes, you can." And I don't remember telling him that, but he did, you know, to make, and now he's a cardiac surgeon. And so that kind of behavior is exactly what you want to do, because those are watching you may not find out about till years later. And there will be casualties as you change things. You know, there's things that are going to change here at the hospital and clinic over time. You know, as healthcare reform comes, your referral source now, people come from all over. You have trauma coming in here. It's you're really on the map. You're the place. And so as things go forward, and everybody does have healthcare and things change, you'll see things change too, just by the nature of things. And accepting these casualties really signifies your commitment, saying, "I know it's different than it used to be, and I know it wasn't what it was like, but this is really how things change," by saying, "Yes, I know it's that, but because of that, we're going to go forward and do something else." And so it really is part of what we do, and sometimes things will change and people will leave and change. Most people end up in a place that they really need to be, but you do need to take that responsibility. So again, I want to really emphasize modeling the behavior you are asking of others. I was raised by many surgeons that perhaps didn't do that every minute of every day. We were able to scream and yell and do what we wanted, and we were noisy. If I were to describe us in the 80s, we were a group of noisy people. And now those kind of behaviors really we find aren't safe. If you have an operating room that is not under control and going well, it's not safe for the patient and your outcome won't be as good. And certainly communication is really at the key of things that do not go well in the hospital. Communication with nursing, communication with patients. And if you cannot communicate, then things won't go so well. And this is a great quote by Ralph Waldo Emerson, "What you do speaks so loud, I cannot hear what you say." And so part of that is you really want to make sure that you communicate in a good fashion. Yelling is a form of communication. It's just probably not the best. And so I think as you go forward, being a good communicator and having great behavior is helpful. So the challenge of leadership is when you try to get things changing. And I did that at Hopkins. It was a great place, but we needed to become contemporary. We did lots of things. We've accepted residents from all over the country and world down into the program. We used to only accept a few. We only had 600 applicants when I first got there. Now we have over 1,000 because people didn't think we would take them. We only had 10% women applicants in 2003, and now we have 60%, and that's pretty much seen across the country now that the medical school classes, which are about half to 60% women, that those women are applying to surgery programs. You have quite a few here in your program as well, about 30% this year. And because of that, you need to work with differences. You're going to see different people come in, different passions, different conflicts, and that really makes this all better. So you really need to do that because you don't want anything to be destroyed, and you want to constructively harness this whole energy that comes with change versus letting it erupt or cause erosion. So another book that is very good is this Leading From Within, and it's all about poetry. So for those of us that loved English but just couldn't figure out what to do with it, Poetry That Sustains the Courage to Leave, and this is by Intrater and Scribner, and I'm going to show you a few of the poems, but it's a great book to use, and I got it from a leadership course that I took. So one thing that they talk about is that if you are a leader, you have to listen to yourself. So you need to develop a very good inner voice. And in order to do that, you need to get away from the noise sometimes. So the noise of work and time and people telling you things. My first 2 weeks at Davis, you know, everybody wants more money, they want a building, they want this, they want more people, and you just write it all down, and then you have to step back to see exactly, do they really need that building? You know, do they really, don't they already have a building to do that? And so to do that, you need moments to provide personal encounters with yourself. And I want to thank you. You gave me some of that here where we sat and just thought. And sometimes they're heartbreaking, where you have to sort of make big decisions. Because one thing is true, when you're a leader, not everyone's going to like you. And that's really tough. For those of us that like to be liked, Betty Davis said, if everyone loves you, you're doing something wrong. You know, so because when you take some resource and give it to Joe, you know, then Bill's going to be mad, you know, and so that you'll never have everyone like you, and therefore those decisions you need to make with a lot of thought and peacefulness. This poem is in the book from The Little Gidding, T.S. Eliot. We shall not cease from exploration, and the end of all our exploring will be to arrive where we started and know the place for the first time. So the other advice I'd give you is when you show up at a new place, you may think that you've already figured it out in a week or two and you know who likes you and you know who doesn't. I'm going to tell you that all changes over 3 to 6 to 8 months, that pretty soon some of the people that really didn't like you at all actually like you and want to stay. And some people who tried to like you early found out they really don't like you at all. And so this actually will move. So you need to go in a circle and figure out who is on your team over a long period of time. And that only comes with going at the beginning and arriving where you started. You do need to listen. Many of us are great speakers, and we love to talk, but listening maybe is not our skill set, and you really have to actively listen. And when you're sitting trying to figure out what caused a bad outcome at the hospital, what caused a patient to not have the clinic appointment they thought, what caused people to be in the wrong place at the wrong time, you really have to listen to people, and you have to develop a way of doing that. As physicians, we tend to go in a room and we're told you sit down and you look right at that patient and you talk to them. You don't run in and run out. And for those of you that are patients, you know how much that means to you is when the doctor especially sits down, or when they come into your room, they sit down either on your bed or chair to talk to you. One of the most vibrant stories I was ever told about that is John Daly, who talks about this. He's a chair of surgery and he was a dean as well. He got hepatitis C and had a liver transplant. And he also was on the board. He's been a vice president of the college. And I had him come speak to us about 5 years ago about how does it feel to get a liver transplant. And he had never spoken about it before. And he spoke at the Baltimore Academy of Surgery. He said the worst thing about being a patient, that it was no one touched him. So he ended up getting his liver transplant. He had hepatitis C, so that might add something to it. They would come in the room. They would sort of shout at him, but no one held his hand. No one sat and touched him. And he said he really noticed that that really bothered him. And that was a great story for me to know that patients still would like you to come sit down and hold their hand, or when you're giving bad news, to put your arm on their shoulder, whatever you need to do to let them know that they're people and persons that are going on with that process. So you need to learn to fix, advise, and solve. You have to listen to people and whatever it takes that you're comfortable with, so people know you're hearing them. Here's another poem by John Fox. I actually just used this one. I had to give a state of the health system at 8 days at Davis last week, and that was interesting. Luckily, they didn't expect much. I only had 8 days of information. But I used this poem about listening, because I told them I'm going to be listening to all of them. I'm traveling throughout Davis and going to everyone's office. I'm sure you've heard that's a great way to learn about people, is to go into their office instead of yours. Many people spend many days cleaning their office before you come, and you hear about that. And you see what pictures they have on the wall and how they organize themselves, how they treat their assistants, what's their style. And at the same time, you're listening to them talk. So you learn a lot by being in other people's offices. I did that at Hopkins, too. So when someone deeply listens to you, your bare feet are on the earth, and a beloved land that seemed distant is now at home with you. So listening really can make you very smart if you open your ears and eyes. Now, leaders tell lots of stories, and they've heard me tell tons of stories this week. And I've told stories about my kids, and my mother had an abdominal aortic aneurysm that had to be treated. And stories tell you a lot. One I told at my grand rounds, that's what you'll remember. If I put a story frame to it, you'll remember today the little train that could. That's how you're going to remember me forever, because he put my name to a story. And you won't remember how to spell Freischlag, but you'll remember that. And when you tell stories, they really tell you about our values, and they also, you must tell those stories to make yourself real, just like Dr. Daly telling how no one touched him after his liver transplant. So you really need to tell stories. Now, some people are uncomfortable because, you know, you're vulnerable when you tell stories, but as a leader, it really makes people follow you because they heard your story and know that you didn't get here by some miracle or some blessing. I mean, you worked hard too, and some things didn't work out as well, you know, and that you actually haven't gotten everything that you wanted. When I went to Match, I wanted to go to UCSF for residency, as someone's son is, and I ended up at UCLA. Well, that wasn't a bad choice at the end, but I didn't get what I wanted. And now I am told that this is a story, and it is true. One of the vascular fellows who was there, who has subsequently died, he drowned, Bill Krupski, told me years ago that as they sat there and they chose, Paul Ebert was chair then, and he took all the women, all four of us, and put us on the bottom. And so he wasn't taking a woman resident at UCSF. So even if I had come, if I'd gotten in some way, he wouldn't have liked me much. Where at UCLA, there were three of us that year, three women interns in 1980, which was three more than they'd ever had. And so they had just finished the first woman chief resident there. I was the sixth one to finish. So part of leadership is scary, and I think a lot of us feel sort of lost with healthcare right now because we're not really running the show. You know, it seems like it's coming from somewhere. We're not quite sure where, and you feel really lost. And so this poem by Zipret says, tell me what scares you the most when you get lost. You know, can you draw from deep inside that what you use to hold you up? Do you move yourself differently? Tell me. And I think the best thing about healthcare right now is just take care of the patient. If you have a lot of patients, which you do, and you just take care of the patient and you do the right thing, the appropriate thing, we talked about that a lot this week, about efficacy and effectiveness and appropriateness and all the type of therapies you need, you'll probably have stuff to do and you'll probably get paid. You know, so I think if you just take care of the patients, have lots of patients, and then really do what you're supposed to do, I think you'll be all right, because you're going to be a good doctor. Dr. McKittrick said he always told his trainees, there's always room at the top, he told me. And that's how he, and there is. There's always room at the top. And there's always room for a good doctor. So leaders do cultivate an organization's creative imagination. And one of my worries about healthcare is that we're going to lose creativity and innovation because we're so busy decreasing length of stay and being cost effective and making sure you get, you know, an outpatient MRI and not an inpatient MRI. And all of that is very, very important. We want to cut costs. We don't want to spend. Part of the reasons I took this job is we're going to try to align all the UC healthcare systems together, and we're doing supply chain and we're doing revenue sharing. I mean, all of that's important, but part of what we do is to create new ways of taking care of people and new ways of diagnosing disease and preventing it. And that is the heart. You have to keep reminding people that that's still going on. And I saw that this week, where you want to teach them about how to be creative and how to think of something new. And when I was at the tumor boards, you know, what's available. And you have to inspire them to keep having innovative thinking, even though you can really get bogged down on all the other things you have to do. And that's tough. You know, there's MALTS and there's MOST now and there's FORMS and there's EPIC and there's IEL, CBT TOADS, and there's just tons that we're going to have to do. ICD-9's going to 10, and there's supposed to be lots of codes, and you have to check everything. But the biggest thing is you want to make sure that we keep being innovative, whether it's how you run your clinic, how you do your research, how you take care of people, and especially for your young people. This is a poem by Willem Blake, Auguries of Innocence. To see a world in a grain of sand, and a heaven in a wildflower, hold infinity in the palm of your hand, and eternity in an hour. And I think this is really innovation. You know, if you think of that, if you can have that imagination, it is great. And this other poem by Reb Nachman is, I use this a lot with residents, is that when you're doing new operations that you've never done, or some laparoscopic thing that is a narrow bridge you can't hardly see, is that to pretend like the entire world is a very narrow bridge, and the essential thing is to have no fear at all, to go forward and to really have no fear at all as you go forward, especially as a leader. So leaders need to foster renewal also. You can't always challenge people endlessly. They need to feel comfortable. You have to develop habits that restore energy, vitality amidst your busyness. You have to understand that we do our best work when we are inspired and challenged and absorbed in conversations about the meaning of our lives and work. And so really coming up with renewal. So young people have it right. They know when they take time off. They exercise, they're healthier than we were, and certainly anything you can do to revitalize yourself is very important. My husband and I walk a lot, I'm a swimmer, I read lots and lots of books. I think all those kind of things, whatever it is, it recharges you. Our son Taylor is one of those I people. I'm an E, as you know, very extroverted. He recharges by not talking to no one. He's finishing up school next week, and he's going to come visit us in Sacramento, and he really wants no input. You know, he wants his Xbox, he wants pizza, and he wants no input, you know, to do it. Don't take me anywhere. So figure out how you recharge and go forward. This poem by Heaney talks about sea change. So hope for a great sea change on the far side of revenge. Believe that a farther shore is reachable from here. Believe in miracles and cures and healing wells. And that's really the spirit you need to continue despite these times, so that people believe that we are going somewhere and that there will be a change as we go forward. So how do you do this? You have to create some sort of holding environment that people like to be around you. You have to control the temperature as you make it go up and down. You have to pace the work so you don't go too fast for people. And when things have all changed at Hopkins, they'll say everything's different. They don't remember why. They don't remember how. They don't remember was that painful. It's just all of a sudden there's no gold surgery. There's no blue surgery. It's all disease-based. We don't have super chiefs. There's more fellows. There's da-da-da. And they go, oh, my goodness, what happened? And it was sort of like just pacing the change. And always showing the future. Yeah, I had one resident say, you're always talking about where we're going. Why are you doing that? You know, but you need to tell them the future. You know, where are we going? What are we going to accomplish? And have them be part of that vision. So two case things you do, you have to raise the heat. They have to pay attention. You can do that by changing things, altering. I know Davis is nervous. What is she going to do? So I'm going to spend 2 or 3 months. I love starting jobs in February, March, so that July, when our year starts, you can have 2 or 3 ideas. It is going to be different than what they knew. And again, you pay attention to what you can't change that they really want. And then you have to lower the temperature when it's too hot so that people don't get absolutely scared to do anything else and are upset with you. And this is sort of the chart that you'll see in that book that actually by Heifetz that actually looks at adaptive change, looks at how it makes it happen, and ability to bring it back down. Raising the heat is really easy. You know, you can make people nervous in a second. You know, all you have to do with an intern when you're scrubbed with them is say, what are you doing with that hand? You know, they'll shake. You know, it doesn't, there's not much you have to do. But you need to draw attention to tough questions. You know, ask them, why do you come to work every day? That's my biggest one. And sounds simple, doesn't it? But as you go through your life, you need to ask that. Why are you coming to work every day? What you're doing now may not be why you come in 10 years. You have to give them a responsibility. Say, well, you're in charge of that. You run that. If you don't like what I'm saying, then you go run that conference. Or you figure out the call schedule. Or you figure out what we're going to do with that. And you need to bring conflicts to the surface where you say, you know, I know you don't get along with so-and-so. What are we going to do? Let's put you in a room and make that happen. And especially for surgery, but probably all of medicine, there's a lot of gadflags and oddballs. You know, we all are a little odd. We all like that. And you really need to protect those people because they're really a lot of fun and they remember history and they know why they did it. And I think part of this is really being part of the whole system. Lowering the temperature actually is not so bad either. You can help them with technical aspects, whether it's help. You can establish structure for the problem so that they can take the problem to small parts, such as call schedules or who's going to take care of these patients or clinics or whatever you decide to do. You can give role assignments, make sure everybody knows they're part of this solution. You can take back saying, well, I'll take care of that. You know, I know this is too tough. I'll make that happen. I'll call that person. I'll tell them that we're not going to give them the money. I'll tell them that we're not going to support that. I had that happen today at Davis where we're having an issue with one person and I said, well, I'll tell him that he can't have that extra resource, you know, because I don't think that's fair to everyone else, you know. And so the vice dean said, thank you, you know, because that was what he thought too. And then sometimes you need to avoid work a bit and slow down the process, and that actually helps too. And you need to give the work back. You can give it back to their shoulders, place it back where it belongs. You need to make some quick interventions. Sometimes they can't be long and drawn out. Observe, question, interpret, act. I mean, just like you would as a healthcare professional, see what you say, question, and there's some things that just are wrong and that you need to take care of right away. You need to take the heat. I am pretty resilient, thick-skinned. I don't know whether it is because I'm from the Midwest. My grandfather said they'll tell you that you can't do stuff. That's when I skipped first grade. He was a coal miner, and he basically just said, I was so little, he said, they're always going to tell you you can't do stuff, so just tell them you can't. I don't know whether it was my older brother when I skipped a grade sort of never spoke to me for about 30 years. I don't know whether that was it. Or whether it was training in surgery with just you know, a bunch of rowdy people and mainly guys. I don't know where it was, but I think if you really want to do something, you'll take the heat, you'll let the issues ripen, and you'll focus attention on the issue. The most effective way to forge a winning team is to call on the players' need to connect with something larger than themselves. And one of our best poets, Phil Jackson, and boy, can he do that, huh? How many winning teams has he had? He has a ring for every finger, doesn't he? And he still can do it. And that is the key, isn't it, is to get people to realize it's just not about them. We do that with our children. We do that with our partners. We do that with residents. We do that with people in the gas station who won't pay attention to you. You know, we do it all of that because it's a bigger picture. And don't you love it when people actually really pay attention to the whole big picture and you don't have to communicate that? Or when your kid figures out they should just show up and they don't really want to be there, but they know it's appropriate because the family's there, or whatever it is. So if you can really can get them to connect, that really helps. So this is my last poem for tonight, and then I certainly will take any questions. This is my favorite poem, and actually I used it, and my new assistant came up to me because she knows I like poems, and she said, you ever use this poem? And I was like, oh, we're going to get along just great, because Vanita brought this in. So this is Frost, as many of you know. So there these two roads, and I couldn't go on both of them, okay? And that's going to be our whole life. But I stood and looked down one as far as I could and to see where it bent out of the grove. And then I took the other just as far, and having perhaps a better claim, because it was grassy and wanted wear, though it was that, for that passing there had one warned them really about the same. And both that morning equally lay in leaves, no step had trodden back. Oh, I kept the first for another day, yet knowing how way leads on to way, I doubted if I ever should come back. And I shall be telling this with a sigh, somewhere ages and ages hence, two roads diverged in a wood, and your kids are going to have this, the residents, your faculty, your partners, every, and I took the one less traveled, and I think we're actually sitting at almost a diverging roads every day now, in healthcare and in politics, in global warming, whatever it is, every day. And that has made all the difference. And I'll tell you, my choices as I've gone through has always taken that different road. You know, I was at Hopkins for 11 years. I have an option now to be a vice chancellor and dean. I'm going to figure out what that means, and I'll send you a note about what that job really is. But I really think that I want to be involved with helping with healthcare systems, be involved with UC, and really help lead all of us to where we want to go, because we are going on a road that's traveled less. We don't know really what it was, but you want to take that road where it makes all the difference. And that difference comes from those that you've taught that feed back to you, those that you get to care for, your patients, those that you get to know as friends. I can't tell you how wonderful Ron and Beverly have been for us this week, and all the people that make a difference in your life here and why you come back to work every day here in Santa Barbara, because you make a difference and it's a road less traveled. So what were the greatest joys? I loved watching others grow. I love seeing cultures change. I love being part of leadership teams. Teamwork is so important now. And I like voicing that difference of opinion because I think I have a different perspective where I sit. The greatest woes is when they don't do what you want. And for all of you that run businesses and kids, but they just don't do what you want. The worst thing is lack of integrity. I must admit, you know, we had core values for my department, and we voted for them at a holiday party. We all had little pieces of paper, big garbage cans. We voted for five. Number one is integrity, and then teamwork, communication, and trust. But integrity, if you don't have that, you have nothing. Professionalism also is critical as we go forward. You must be professional. And when they can't solve their own problems, you know, you give them a lot of opportunity and they just can't do it. And that's when you get really frustrated. The toughest jobs is money. You know, it's always money. Above and below, we'll all have money issues. That's going to be tough. Telling someone they didn't do a good job, they didn't hit the mark, that's so tough because they wanted to. And then realizing some people think women shouldn't lead. So that's sort of my private one, where you could just sort of tell that they're just not into you. Part of it is you can move on, but now that I've gotten older, I just tell them they're wrong. Okay. This is when, as we left Hopkins, Phil's been such a great partner with my group that they really felt that we had made them better. And that was probably the best thing I've ever been told. We went to multiple parties, and basically is you made them better. I made the division stronger. I made everybody better. And that, there's nothing better than hearing you made people better. Now, I'm sure I made them mad, and I disappointed them, a few other things, but I eventually made them better. And this one from Lao Tzu is, when the best leader's work is done, the people will say we did it ourselves. And that's why I left Hopkins, is that they all can do it themselves now. I've got great division chiefs. They'll have a new leader. And I came to Davis because I think that they need some help with leadership so that they can be a more vibrant medical center. They're a fabulous place, but there's things that we can do to be more part of patient-centered care, more part of the UC system, and more innovative where we're going. So I want to thank you for Phil and I for being here this week and giving us an opportunity to learn from you. I learned how to do best breast cancer care better. I learned how your ICUs work. I learned how wonderful your surgery residents are and how smart they are. They did tell me multiple secrets last night at dinner, and I will, for a price, tell you what they said to me. Otherwise, it's mum's the word. One's Burgundy sitting right there. They were wonderful and honest and energetic. And I really learned, whenever you do these things, you think I come to teach you, you always learn something, you take back, and I will take back the spirit of Santa Barbara and your community and your hospital to Davis. So thank you very much.
I'm sure there are a few questions. teacher didn't disappear. Any questions? I do want to share one other. I shared this with the department survey. I want to share it with you all. When I look up Freischlag, it's an interesting word. And Germans tend to put words together. Frei means free, and Schlag means a hammer and a blow. And her parents and in-laws were stonemasons. That's where it came from. But there's a Viennese word that I like better. And that Schlag, or mit Schlag, which is whipped cream.
Thank you very much.
Any other questions?
Questions or comments?
Yes, please.
My name is Julie, too.
I love that. Her name is Julie.
I wish I did. But I would like to know, do you miss being in an operating room and a hands-on work that you did so successfully and so well?
She's asking me whether or not I miss being a surgeon and having hands-on. Well, I haven't stopped. So even though I do this, I'm actually a specialist in thoracic outlet syndrome. So for the last 11 years at Hopkins, I was taught by Dr. Mackletter at UCLA. I've developed a huge practice in thoracic outlet syndrome. And so I operated every week with my fellows and saw clinic. I was in clinic 2 days a week. I did quit taking call 5 years ago, and that felt really good. This year when I'm going to be president of the Society for Vascular Surgery, and one of my patients who had a ruptured aneurysm is going to come and say a few words. He's 8 years out from a ruptured abdominal aortic aneurysm, so I still see patients. I'm still going to see patients at UC Davis. I have a young faculty member, Misty Humphreys, who's a vascular surgeon, and we're going to do the thoracic outlet patients together. I was just looking at all the instruments. They sent me pictures today so we can get the right instruments and retractor. I'm still waiting for my license. There's one more little piece to that. They have to tell me at Milwaukee that I was safe, and we haven't quite heard from them. But I will practice a bit at Davis as well. Probably not as much, but you're so right. I miss those patients. I answered a few of them by email today. I take care of young patients that have artery and vein troubles with their arms and neurogenic pain, and I have made that part of my work. I think to run healthcare centers and to run departments of surgery, you have to be seeing patients. Otherwise, you're so removed from it that you really can't make that. And then some days you actually know how to see a patient and take care of them, so you can actually go do that, where whether making decisions on budgets or how to tell someone they can't do something or how to rein someone in, you probably don't have that skill set, but you do know how to go see a patient. So I haven't had to miss it yet because I'm continuing to do that. And people that know me say that's one of the days that I have a great day, is when I get to do an operation or take care of a patient. Thanks.
I do want to remind everyone that across the street, the Sansum building is a reception, and you're all invited to that. And if you have other questions, you can see that she's very approachable, and you can ask her almost any question, I think.
Almost any question. Thanks so much.